name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and with your spirit. Brothers and sisters, welcome to the Church of the Most Holy Trinity this morning for this celebration of the Mass on this, the final Sunday before the great season of Lent. And so let us acknowledge our sins, that we may the better prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Kyrie eleison. Kyrie eleison. Christe eleison. Christe eleison. Kyrie eleison. Kyrie eleison. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who teach us that you abide in hearts that are just and true, grant that we may be so fashioned by your grace as to become a dwelling pleasing to you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God for ever and ever. Amen. A reading from the book of Leviticus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, if a swelling or scab or shiny spot appears on a man's skin, a case of leprosy of the skin is to be suspected. The man must be taken to Aaron the priest, or to one of the priests who are his sons. The man is leprous. He is unclean. The priest must declare him unclean. He is suffering from leprosy of the head. A man infected with leprosy must wear his clothing torn and his hair disordered. He must shield his upper lip and cry, unclean, unclean. As long as the disease lasts, he must be unclean, and therefore he must live apart. He must live outside the camp. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Whatever you eat, whatever you drink, whatever you do at all, do it for the glory of God. Never do anything offensive to anyone, to Jews or Greeks or to the Church of God. Just as I try to be helpful to everyone at all times, not anxious for my own advantage, but for the advantage of everybody else, so that they may be saved. Take me for your model, as I take Christ. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. May the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ enlighten the eyes of our mind, so that we can see what hope his call holds for us. Alleluia. The Lord be with you, and with your spirit. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. A leper came to Jesus and pleaded on his knees. If you want to, he said, you can cure me. Feeling sorry for him, Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him. Of course I want to, he said, be cured. And the leprosy left him at once, and he was cured. Jesus immediately sent him away and sternly ordered him, mind you say nothing to anyone, but go and show yourself to the priest and make the offering for your healing prescribed by Moses as evidence of your recovery. The man went away, but then started talking about it freely and telling the story everywhere, so that Jesus could no longer go openly into any town, but had to stay outside in places where nobody lived. Even so, people from all around would come to him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. It's impossible for us to understand what leprosy meant to the communities among whom Jesus lived and ministered. Our first reading is taken from the long-established law given to Moses, and the message is actually simple. If you are a leper, you are out. You are declared unclean. You are to wear your clothes torn, deliberately disordering yourself as a warning for others. You are to proclaim that disorder to others, so that they will isolate you, stay away from you. Leprosy was seldom cured. It was a life sentence, or more likely, a death sentence. What remained of life would be spent outside the camp, away from all human contact. A leper was a pariah in culture, in law, in religion. It was a situation virtually devoid of hope. Leprosy is still around today. It goes by the name of Hansen's disease. It's a bacterial infection, and it can be cured. In Jesus' day, they weren't so fortunate. And the law they lived by repeated the phrase over and over again. To be a leper is to be unclean, impure. You are outside the camp, you are isolated. Contact with you makes others unclean. And so an attitude develops in which those who consider themselves clean reject others, stay away from them, do not help them, and look down upon them from a great height. Through history, humans have found ways to legitimize such behaviors against people who are different from them. People of different backgrounds and stories, people with different perspectives. It may be on the grounds of the colour of someone's skin, or their gender, or their sexual orientation. And with varying degrees of subtlety, we distinguish and make judgments between people on first acquaintance. Our reactions to a new story can be formed by the question of who the people involved are, where they come from, what they look like, what they sound like. And we are influenced too by those whose task it is to share such new stories with us. It is hard to cut through all this and to come to realistic judgments and approach such stories with unclouded minds. But back to our leper. He puts his request to Jesus in a very interesting way. Formed by the experiences of being shunned by others, he questions whether Jesus would ever actually want to cure someone like him. To our ears, that suggestion that Jesus might not want to cure him grates on our ears. Why, of course he would. But the leper may well have asked such a question of people a million times before, and being kicked into the gutter. And Jesus does want him. Jesus cures him. Cures him in an instant. Cures him so that no trace remained. Cures him so that the irreversible nerve damage was reversed. The wasting away haunted, the fullness of health, of life, restored. Jesus cuts through centuries of ingrained suffering, prejudice, and hardness of heart. He says the words the leper has never heard, words which speak not just of healing and cure, but of compassion and welcome, acceptance and joy. It's a world away from the world he has known. This does two things. It releases the leper back into the world of normal human society. The second thing it does is to restore to the leper the responsibility for living a full life. As a leper, he earned a living by begging from others, by appealing to the charity of others. It was a meager living, but it was a living. will he earn a living? How will he use his newfound physical health and strength? Questions now bombard him as he rejoices in a new form of freedom. To meet Jesus Christ and to ask the question of him does not simply bring about a miraculous transformation. It bombards us too with questions, for we too are disfigured with imperfect lives and decisions, choices and actions. Meeting Jesus bombards us with questions. What are the decisions that I make? What are the words that I say? Do I examine those actions to see whether they are part of God's will, God's desire for me? How do I work out what that desire is? What do I do with the freedom which knowing Jesus and being known by him gives to me? On Wednesday we will receive another gift from Almighty God, the great gift of Lent, a period of 40 days reflecting Jesus' departure from society into the wilderness, there to commune with his beloved Father and receive the grace which comes from self-denial and fasting. We are given the opportunity to redirect our daily living and ask ourselves just what is important to us. What are we going to do with this newfound freedom, the glorious liberty of the children of God? We will begin with repentance, the turning away from sinful attitudes and thoughts. In our present circumstances, there will be three live stream services on Ash Wednesday. The normal offerings of prayer in the morning and in the evening, as well as a celebration of the Mass. In the next day or so, you should receive a newsletter, and with the newsletter, a card with the words that are traditionally used at the point of ashing, and a small sachet containing blessed ash. And using those words, perhaps we might consider anointing ourselves with the ash of penitence on Ash Wednesday, perhaps during that live streamed Mass. Families worshipping together may ash one another. It will be a wonderful opportunity to start our Lenten journey well and truly to turn again to the Lord our God. The leper discovered that Jesus had come to give him life, and that life was the fullest life on offer. He was also to discover that what he did with that life was now up to him. The same choice is ours. Let us take this opportunity during Lent to start again, to replant ourselves in Christ, to seek renewal, restoration, and healing, and life in abundance. Let us proclaim our faith in the words of the Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things. things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. With confidence in God's loving mercy, we bring before him our prayers and petitions. For Bishop Jonathan, for Bishops Michael and Clive, for the whole College of Bishops, may they be renewed in strength, faith and joy. May they, in their turn, give strength to their flocks. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For world leaders, may they work together in good faith and charity to bring good health and protection to all. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For those involved in health care, that they may draw strength from the prayers and goodwill of all God's people. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For all involved in education, for our children and young people, for the staff of our schools, Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For ourselves, that we may enter Lent determined to allow God to shape, restore, and renew us in Christ Jesus. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For the sick and the suffering of our own time and place, for all known to us who need Christ's healing, we pray especially for Anne, baby Arthur, Tony Arthurs, Val Beckett, Norman Bowden, Amelia Butler, Samuel Bruno Priest, John Clues, Harry Crookson, Jesse Eggleston, Brenda Feeney, Joe Fielder Priest, Sue Fowles, Christine Gilbert, Hannah Giles, Kath Hale, Keith Henwood, Anne Hill, Chris Hill, Lindy Humphrey, Alan Hyde, Gareth Jones Priest, Geraldine Long, Gary Moore, Mark McIntyre Priest, Geraldine Nixon, Mary Pearson, Rita Penn, Trish Porter, Cheryl Powell, Stuart Powell Priest, Blandy Richards, Stephen Richardson, Phil Round, Paul Seagraves, Sheila, Beatty Smith, Ron Spearman, Paul Sumner, Lily May Thornton, Giles Tinsley, Jenny Tinsley, Nigel Tinsley, Eric Tomlinson, Priest, Joe Turner, Wynne Turner, John Walker, Pat Watts, Jenny Winwood, Julie Whitehouse, Eric Walton, Betty Fenner, Betty Barnett, Brian Foster, Glenn Harrison, Angela Porter, Chloe Burns, Peggy Porter, Eddie Payne, Jesse Eccleston, and Father Roger Gilbert. For these and all who need Christ's healing, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We commend to the Lord all who have died. May they have light and peace. We remember especially Bill Neal, Violet Brooks, Jean Pinney, John Bolas, Olga Jennings, and Ian Young, priest. And for Ted Jones, Dorothy Padmore, George Paddock, Michelle Hall, Graham Dodd, and Joan Davis, all of whom have died recently. And for those whose anniversaries occur at this time, among them Joseph Jones, Nigel Ball, Oscar Abrahams, Jeff Ball, Alfred Robotham, Bill Stretton, Arthur Corbett, Rose Huff, Kate Croydon, William Foster, John Griffin, Phoebe Evans, and James Evans. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We now ask Mary, our Blessed Lady, to intercede for us in our prayers. As we say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. We now offer our personal prayers and intentions to our Lord. Lord our God, help us to love you above all things with a love that is worthy of you. Look kindly on the prayers of your people made today through your Son Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice of my hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy Church.
May this oblation, O Lord, be prayed, cleanse and renew us, and may it become for those who do your will a source of eternal reward, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection.
you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Jonathan, our bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you, and with your spirit. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go forth. The Mass is ended. Thanks be to God.